this is episode 3 of Haramcore Inc. With me are Paresh and Kunal from Stark Denial.
Yeah!
Hey guys, what's up?
I suck at
it. You are not the vocalist, dude.
Yeah. Like, leave it to the vocalist.
Exactly.
You should be doing doom.
Today is going to be the CORPSEPAINT edition because we're going to talk a lot about black metal from the subcontinent. We're going to talk about Stark Denial's new album, Covenant of Black. And a lot of contemporary things about the music and the scene that exists since 30 years now? Since black metal has been brought into this world, more than 30, I guess.
More than 30 years.
See, Venom was the first black metal
first
band,
wave,
yeah.
Right?
First wave.
That would be more than 38-ish, maybe, I don't know. Closing to around 40, maybe. Anyway, I just want to know, talking about recent things, were you all there at Bangalore opener?
Yes,
How was it?
Both of us love Alcest so much. Fuck, dude, to witness that in India,
mm-hmm.
It was something crazy. That was the first gig which I went to and I was sober, man. So, I enjoyed it more.
Why was that?
Because he was that expensive, man. $500 for a bottle. Oh, so, I was
it was pretty expensive.
I told him, are you peeking on Amazon? Tabby gave me a sip, man. So, I drank beer.
No, he's always there. He's like that. Tabby's a good guy.
He gave you a sip, but you drank the entire shit.
No. One-third, man. Come on.
So many people give you beer. Dude, Gareth gave you.
Yeah.
Ajay gave you.
Everyone loves Paresh. Right? Paresh is like that guy. Sab log aisa aake, are Paresh, bro. And then
except one guy.
Kyu?
Achha, we can't talk about that. We'll talk about it later.
Yeah, seeing Alcest is probably the first band that I heard in this shoegaze genre.
Uh-huh.
And to witness them live was really, really amazing. The experience was brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
And the crowd also loved them.
Yeah, actually, there's a lot of people from Bombay that literally were looking forward to the show for All Sisters.
In fact, I want to say this. There was one band who was performing and they said that, okay, before the disco shit starts, let's...
Oh, damn, your favorite band, no.
No, that's your favorite band, dude. So they called Alcest in
fuck
a way disco.
Band. It hurt my feelings,
and,
man.
It was really fuck all. But Alcest did not give a fuck. Neither did the people. And they enjoyed.
Was it Cryptos?
I don't know.
I wasn't there. So.
I don't know.
They're pretty cheeky.
I love Cryptos.
I know them.
Cryptos
they're very cheeky.
Cryptos is good in their own league. Yeah, they are definitely doing something really good for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
They're one of the oldest bands, in fact.
Right.
They're doing pretty good,
mm-hmm.
But yeah, that shouldn't have been said, but jokes apart.
Yeah. What about the rest of the acts? Immolation and...
Immolation nailed it big time.
He likes Immolation a lot.
Immolation.
I saw Bob Vinia play and it was...
Fuck, he's
fuck.
A maniac.
I was blown away. I don't listen to death metal much, but I told him, fuck, look at this guy.
He
man.
Was ripping it.
Bob and Ross.
I think
nailed it.
He kind of stole the show. Like, nobody spoke so much about Overkill as much as everyone spoke
Overkill?
About Immolation.
Overkill were also.
See, even
energetic.
Though I love thrash metal,
yeah.
But they are like a little different league of thrash metal, you know?
Yeah, they're very typically thrash. Like, they're the thrashiest thrash.
The
there.
American
yeah.
80s
Brand
thrash.
Of,
but
yeah.
The new drummer of Overkill killed it. He was really amazing.
I traveled only to watch Alcest.
Right. A lot of Bombay people.
Yeah.
A lot of Bombay people.
After that, I even left early, you know. Mm-hmm. Fuck me, ja raha hai.
Yeah, because last
fucked.
Year what happened mm-hmm. when Marduk cancelled,
mm-hmm.
everybody got mind fucked.
Oh, yeah, right.
So,
right.
We watched Nile
right.
and which other man?
Last year was...
Corona.
Corona
and
yeah,
Nile.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then Nile, Paresh moshed and
yeah, these
we
guys
pushed him.
Pushed me in the mosh pit. Man, look at my size.
That was pretty insane. But yeah, Immolation this year was really good. Alcest was...
So, were there a lot of other black metal, old crowd attending?
There were, in fact. There were people from Kochi.
Uh-huh.
There were the Bangalore crowd.
Uh-huh.
There were people from Bombay as well. Surprisingly, who I did not know who even listened to Alcest. But when Alcest plays, they were making heart shapes and one guy was pelting
girls
his chest.
Girls were crying.
Girls
and Kunal is look at that girl, look at that girl. I'm like, oh, damn.
Girls were crying.
The band has a lot of crossover appeal. It's not
Dude,
they were playing Fuck, they were so beautiful, man.
They played Kodama, right?
Man,
yeah, yeah, they started
man,
with Kodama.
Feels better, but it was
insane. No, it was as good as listening to a CD.
And, they, and according to me, they had the best sound.
Yeah, the sound was also really amazing.
He sounded so good, man.
But don't you think, like, so the old schoolers took a piss at them, right?
Yeah, because they were all having beers
at
the back.
But they always do that with all the bands.
They always will. So, so as, you know, guys keeping up old school black metal alive, I consider you all to be pretty straight up, no bullshit old school black metal.
Yeah.
And what's your thoughts on, like, how Alcest, or, sorry, my bad, how bands like Alcest are perceived by, you know, your old school metalers?
See, the old school metalers, they have the typical cult following. They like only old school death. Uh-huh. They will not listen to bands which are coming out nowadays who are still doing a pretty good job.
Mm-hmm.
There are bands like Blood Incantation. There are bands like Tomb Mold. There are bands like Skeletal Remains who have that. They are the new old school death metal bands.
Right, right.
But they're these guys will still stick to old Morbid Angel, old Opposition, which are also
and they'll
good.
Be like such poser bands, man. New bands, man. Fuck this shit. But fuck, they're old school bands, man. Just because they have a little polished sound, you can't just piss at them, man. Come on, go to the topic.
Yeah, in fact, I know one guy. If you've heard Niles' Black Seeds of Vengeance.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And if you compare that album's sound, production-wise, it is a little bit low. But that is how they wanted it. The later on albums, Annihilation of the Wicked, everything was, the production was really good. So I asked this dude, do you like Black Seeds of Vengeance? He's like, I like it, but production-wise, it sucks. I was like, if that is how they want it, they made it like that.
Sometimes you need to just pay attention to the craft and the songs more than the production also.
Yeah, because if you have everything high pitch, everything, you know, loud, the drums are loud, the kicks are loud, then the actual essence gets killed.
And I blame home production to be the bane of everything. Every fucking idiot is an expert now, no?
Yeah.
Because you'll buy yourself a pair of expensive headphones, you'll buy, you know, some gear, you'll try doing some ghar pe baith ke, you'll do your mixes. And then everyone's now a
production expert.
And then they'll always have an opinion about production being very, like, crucial part of a listening experience. I mean, sure, it has its merits. But I think the critique has, sometimes it gets too far, like, you know, it comes in the way of the, between, like, the listener and the music. They're not paying attention to the music. Like, wo log sidechain compression mein ghusta hai.
But I'll tell you a funny part, like, as you were talking about being old school and, you know, like, even though you would consider us, like, old school and we have a particular followers and, all old school band would like us, it's not like that.
Right.
Like, for example, as like Bangalore scene or Hyderabad scene or Kochi
Kolkata?
Scene.
What about Kolkata?
Calcutta scene is very different.
Very different.
Very different.
Not Calcutta.
Ha. Same thing. But
If we are Bombay, they are Calcutta.
But if we are Mumbai, then...
But come on. Yeah.
So yeah, you're saying.
So the thing is, I don't think they appreciate other old school bands as much as they appreciate themselves, you know. Like, for example, if I would ask Kryptos, like, do you like Sargon and the old school, I'm pretty sure they would be like, that would be the answer, man.
Possibly.
Because this is happening.
And all that will happen, yeah.
Yeah. See, like, for example, I love old school music, okay? If you would ask me...
Yeah, yeah, we were having a discussion. So I was trying to ask Paresh, like, you know, have you been checking out some, some of the newer black metal releases? And not black metal, I'm talking about fringe, crossover, mixed genre black metal. For example, we were talking about this band called Zeal and Ardor. So it's... Have you checked them out?
Yeah, yeah.
He has checked out everything
so
on planet Earth.
I found it very damn fascinating. So, like, for our listeners to get some context, Zeal and Ardor is basically this band that's a black man from France who took up a project as a challenge when they said that make African soul, like, no, sorry. The exact words on that was said to him were make black metal meets nigger music. And he took it in a good spirit, and he actually made soul music and, you know, folk music of, like, the Southern America, like the slaves. So he took the slaves music, and then he's like basically gave it a thought that if they went to Christ for emancipation, like, you know, to be freed, like, at least spiritually, but what if they turned to Satan instead? And that is the concept that he used to make really good music. So, and it's fusing, like, pretty much, like, soul, R&B and folk with, like, black metal, screeching black metal, like, riffs. So what was your idea, like, you know, how, what did you
want
it to be?
But who's Satan, man? Satan is just like any other god.
Ha, huh, kind of. He's more of a pagan, the original gods, as they say. But yes.
Oh, can I say this? Because in a bat, everybody, Christians.
Ha,
not everybody, it's just me and Roa.
Ha, matlab, but...
Ek chutiya to mallu hai.
Paresh, tu bhi Christian hai kya?
मैं रात को सोने के बाद मैं वो सपने देखता है. I go to a graveyard.
When it comes to, I would say, fusion music, one of my very top favorite bands would be Summoning.
Mm-hmm.
Because Summoning,
fuck yeah, Ukraine Black Magic.
You should listen to them. They basically fuse the old Lord of the Rings.
Oh,
yeah. The epic.
I think I'll send you a link, right, to Summoning?
I don't think so, not Summoning.
But Summoning, it's not like, a lot of people still don't like them because people just want fast guitars,
blast beats.
But these guys, if a song starts with the guitars and the drums, and then after that you just have these synths which takes you in a totally different
vibe altogether.
So people there over there, okay, I don't listen to this shit. They stop it.
You know
there.
Who's the one act I know in India who's doing this exact thing? I don't know if you like them or not. They're a Chennai-based band. They're called, what are they called? Diabolus Arcanum.
Yeah,
I've seen them. They had come down to Vashi. They had played at Marine Center. Sadly, on that day, when they were on stage, they were little kids, man. I felt so bad. Everybody felt so bad for them. So they are playing a song and they are synth-based. They did not have a keyboardist.
Okay.
I think they did not even have a drummer. But they were playing on stage and in the middle of the song, their laptop crashed.
Oh, okay, for the synths. Okay.
Samples. Even drums, no. And
they were playing without a drummer.
Yeah. Drums and...
Yeah, because I think it was originally a two-man project. And Harshavardhan was managing them back in the day.
Yeah, I think Jeff is really good friends with them.
Because when that happened after that, I think so, the vocalist approached me to play for BMK. Because we were planning another edition for BMK.
Right.
But that did not happen. Uh-huh. So he had asked me that, you know, we would like to play...
Black Metal.
This was 3, right?
Black Metal Krieg. Mm-hmm. So this is Black Metal Krieg that we're talking about. This is India's only Black Metal...
Asia's only festival.
Asia's only
Black Metal Fest.
Wow. You'd like to make that claim, right? It's Asia's only.
Yes.
Or South Asia's.
No, Asia's.
Wow, excellent. So, I mean, I have a dear friend who's obviously been there with the BMK crew since day one, Sanjeev Gupta.
Sanjeev
did a lot of good shows in Pune also with y'all.
With
In fact, my first gig in Pune was a gig with Atmosphere and y'all only, I think. Y'all were on the same.
The same show. My show.
The basement shows, which was basically they were called Entombed Metal Fest.
By Frameshift.
Yes.
Okay, just to clarify, basement show is actually bands playing in a basement, not fucking in the basement. People don't think basement show.
But Ruak would differ, man.
Ruak. Paresh is yours.
Fuck Ruak, man.
In fact, that was Paresh's first gig with us. So Paresh was... Were you nervous?
Oh.
Not at all. I was headbanging during
Paresh
sound check.
Paresh and me both had our first gigs there.
Oh, cheers,
yeah. Cheers
man.
To that.
Cheers, man.
And in fact, on that gig also, Pritesh was playing drums for us. Pritesh Prabhune.
Because
that time, Shauvik had just left the band for other reasons. Mm. So we did not have a drummer. So Pritesh... was playing with us for
a few
shows.
Was there a Black Metal Krieg that happened in that year afterwards?
We've done four...
A year after that.
Four editions. Yeah, we had a year break. Mm-hmm. And then we decided to come back with the fourth edition.
We did in 14 and 15.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So, these were the last of the few gigs that happened in Thane, I think.
United
21.
It was the last gig in Thane, was it?
In United 21?
Huh.
Yeah, there was a reason for it.
Because they
started charging for entertainment tax.
They started charging entertainment tax
and
the rent.
We had lost a lot of money in Black Metal Krieg. Imagine.
There was a genuine wave of interest in Black Metal, at least in the West. Like, if I'm talking about Bombay, Pune region. Because that's where, like, we've also, like, done maximum of our, you know, attending and playing shows. So, in that period, like, Cosmic had a great... run of shows. They put out their live DVD, they have put out their album. They had such a great run. And at the same time, I think, on the other end of the spectrum, there was Solar DT doing like three albums, like EPs in a year.
Not even EPs, singles.
No. There were EPs. There were three EPs.
You've been following.
Yes. No, that's because I kind of, as
no,
much
even
as...
No, even I like Solar DT, but...
Yeah.
Okay.
As
but,
much as, like, you know,
but,
as acerbic as Aditya Mehta can be, and he will admit to it as well, because, like, you know, at least he wears it on his sleeve. but
only on social media, not in person.
Yeah, in person he's actually a different person.
Dekho bhaiya, sab record pe ja raha.
But in person he's like a puppy, man. Honestly, man.
I have not met the man personally. But yes, so coming back. So that wave was really great for black metal at that point of time. I mean, and plus, obviously, I'm sure it was... a good amount of it, I can definitely say, is credited to the creation of Black Metal Krieg.
Yeah.
So, could you tell us more about it?
See, Black Metal Krieg, initially what happened is when my mother passed away, I was in a totally shit phase. I quit the band. I wanted to basically quit my job and just lie in one corner.
Right.
So, then my brother told me that, you know, you can't just quit everything and just sit. You have to do something. So then I told the band guys, okay, you know, let's do something. I want to do this in honor for my parents. So I wanted to do something which was never done in India before.
Right.
So then we got down to thinking, you know, what should we do? So that's when, since we are a black metal band, and black metal is very rare and scarce in India.
Right.
So then that's when we decided to come up with a show only for black metal.
Mm-hmm.
So the first edition we had was at B69. It was Stark Denial, Spike Crib. Dishti from Sri Lanka approached us.
Oh wow, okay.
So they told us, you know, we heard that you guys are doing an all black metal show. We would like
to
come.
Right.
So we told them upfront, see, we are doing this for the very first time, so we cannot pay you any travel or anything. They said, don't worry, we'll manage everything on our own. So we were like more than happy, fuck, an international band coming for the first time, for the first
but
edition
it's
of
for the spirit of the
yeah. So we were like, sure, why not? Then we had 1833,
right,
AD from
Delhi. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So this was the first edition, which was pretty good.
It
went off pretty well. So then we said,
and it was on 26 December. I still remember.
Yeah, it was in December.
Oh.
We always had
December.
This to keep it in December.
Okay.
So then a lot of people.
It was winter's coming.
It was post the coming of Christ. So the Antichrist is born on the next day.
ऐसा मत बोल यार इधर क्रिश्चियन दे बांदे.
I have to make. Black metal allegory.
But
it's
like,
black
but
metal.
Yeah,
but,
yeah,
but
I,
you can,
I want
you,
to speak about
yeah,
that.
Even, even people
think,
I want to speak about that.
Address it. Address
people
it.
Think black metal is all about Satan and
Satanism.
Worship,
yeah.
Which is wrong. Yes, initially when it started off with all the church burnings and the killing of ex-band members and, you know, using their bone parts and all, eating shit and all.
But they were just against Christianity.
Because
that did not mean they believed in the devil.
Yeah,
they were just
why,
against the concept
exactly
of Christianity.
If
you don't believe in something, that does not mean you have to believe in something else,
right?
Right,
right. Coming back to Black Metal Krieg.
Yeah.
So, so how did it like grow from there? How was the first edition? Like, I wasn't there for any of the Black Metal Kriegs. What was it like in those first few editions? Like,
see, the first edition was pretty good. And because what happened is BMK was actually as a platform which gave exposure to a lot of Indian bands.
Right, right.
Namely 1833 AD.
Right,
I think
right.
So their first show was BMK.
Okay,
in Bombay.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me? How like long were they existing before that?
They were there. Someone told me, I think so, if I'm not mistaken, it was Ashwin Sharma who told me there's this band from Delhi, 1833
AD. It was 2008.
Yeah.
Wow, okay.
So he told me that these guys are there, and if you can speak to them, they would be interested to come down, because playing in your own town, you would obviously want to play somewhere else.
Right, right, right.
And Mumbai, Bombay, being one of the like happening places for metal in general, not just one genre.
Right, right.
So definitely, I spoke to them. They were like, you know, cool, we are ready to come down and stuff. They're like, just cover what you can, whether travel or stay. So we chipped in from our own pockets and all. And because since Dishti, we saved up on Dishti.
Right.
They came on their own. So we said, let's, Spiker was a local band.
Right.
We are a local band. So
right.
We said, let's invest on these guys traveling. We heard their songs. They were pretty tight. Like, come down.
Mm-hmm.
So that happened. Then after that, we got more bands approaching us.
Mm-hmm.
I think so the second edition featured Dark Desolation.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it was their first gig.
Mm-hmm.
The second edition was a comeback for Cosmic.
Right, right.
After Chetan went into hibernation.
Fuck, I missed that Cosmic Infusion so much.
What was the difference, man? I wouldn't know because I've seen this era of Cosmic.
It was totally different. You can't compare that Cosmic and this Cosmic.
Why?
It's way different.
Why? I want the sound,
the showmanship, everything.
Because he was the frontman.
Yeah.
Yes, you should see
him. Dude, I have heard infamous stories of him taking blood.
He has.
Like,
he goes into the forest and wanders and whatnot.
Amarnath, man.
Yeah, Amarnath.
He's from Amarnath.
When the first Stark Dinner song was recorded,
right,
we put it on MySpace. That time MySpace
then,
was active.
Right, right.
Called the Unknown World. I pinged him the link. He was like taken apart like crazy.
Yeah, dude,
we have to do a gig together. I said, you have to meet me for that first. Then we can start discussing.
Okay.
He was so brutal on stage and he was such a nice person off stage, man. You would look at him and you'll be like, fuck, that guy's so scary.
We are also brutal on stage and nice off stage.
Except me, man.
You are the full teddy bear off stage. Everyone is coming and cuddling with you at gigs and giving you beer, right?
Paresh is like, instead of CORPSEPAINT up, I mean face paint, Paresh should put something else.
Powder.
Like,
la.
Powder. Thank God you said powder and not cum.
Even I've heard a couple of stories from Black Metal Krieg. Sanjeev specifically. So coming back to like why, like my window to this world is Sanjeev.
Okay.
Anything and everything I know of what you guys did was through him. So he told me once, I think it was Dishti and they wanted to sign their CDs and they needed...
They needed
a needle to draw blood. To sign them and like he had to go fetch needles. He and Ajay, I think,
yeah. Before in the second edition,
he cut himself,
right?
Yeah, he did. He bled on stage, right?
Yeah.
They came back for the second edition. First edition, we had four bands, second edition, we had six bands, so it kept on growing.
And they're a fucking great band, man. I love this team. I love this team.
So, yeah, BMK2 was again, it picked up. So then people like more bands started approaching us,
right.
So then we were like, you know, we can't have so many bands because B69 also has a time limit.
Right.
Then cutting down the slots and all.
Were happening at B69. Right.
So cutting down of slots and all, which some bands did not like, but we did not have a choice.
Correct.
Because obviously every band wants to play equally.
Right.
Until unless like you're like a new band, then okay, you get an opening slot with limited time. Then as the bands keep playing, 5-5, 10-10 minutes gets increased.
Right.
So that happened in BMK2. Then BMK3 and 4 we had it in Thane United Union because B69 shut down, so we were like hunting for venues.
I have heard that B69 shut down because post the Black Metal
something
Green
happened,
night
somebody pissed
it was something damn serious and somebody pissed on the wall of a mandir or some religious.
There was a small mandir next to the stairs
right
over there
and somebody pissed on it and that's the reason why the venue got shut, right?
No, the venue didn't get shut because of that.
Okay.
I mean, that day they told us to clear the shit, and I think so after we left the cops game.
They sent people to hunt for a guy with black t-shirt and a long hair, and then they were just rounding up everyone.
What's the probability of finding that guy,
right? Like that's the most vague description you can give.
One in a billion chances.
But Abhijit can find him, man.
CID references.
But sucks that it shut down.
But yeah, there were multiple reasons. That wasn't the only reason for it.
Got it.
But
got it.
Like, I'm not sure if we can
it
talk
contributed,
about it.
It contributed.
Yeah,
possibly.
Maybe, possible. Not only that particular gig, but that used to keep happening because, see, B69 was next to the Jam Room Bajaj.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's how it all
so people
came
used
to
be there around that area
Correct.
All the time.
Correct.
So, you know how it is, right? Mm-hmm. Like,
I'm
we are
sure
fucking...
People must have sniffed the mal and all that.
Yeah. They would be like, what is going on
definitely,
here?
Definitely, obviously. All of a sudden, you get this stink. Where is it coming from? What is it? Obviously, if you see guys
It was a Ganpati
t-shirts.
Mandir, I still remember.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Black t-shirts and also, obviously, they must have complained and must have...
But then, you don't feel like it probably could have been one of the people attending the show?
It was, for sure.
Oh, matlab misplaced, you know, angst for aisa fuck religion nikal diya na.
Yeah, but
mooth mein nikal diya usne.
But tell me.
Aur bhosada baj gaya Big 69 ka partly because of that.
That is one of the incidents. Like for example, Marine Center shut down just because one guy puked in the swimming pool.
Oh wow. Yeah, this shit happens here.
Huh, so it keeps
you
happening.
You can't predict it. I'll tell you why. It's probably because
in comparison, kids,
yes, and in comparison, venues like antisocial, for example. If some shit goes down, like people like get too drunk, they won't get too drunk because you can't smuggle in alcohol.
Yeah, yeah. And there are bouncers.
And there are age limits, and stupid kids won't get in, like who don't know to handle a drink. And even if you end up getting really sloshed, it's going to either cost you a bomb, so you'll avoid it.
Hmm. Yeah,
or,
yeah, yeah.
You know, even if you do get sloshed, they'll fucking take care of
yeah,
you, they'll throw
exactly,
you out.
Exactly.
And they'll clean up the mess before anything further,
exactly.
Like, you know, it happens. So I guess that venue which takes care of shit didn't exist back then.
B69 was the only standalone venue. It didn't have any hotel attached or
right.
All these antisocial. You have that the socials going on top. So
if
you're coming, people see you.
Yeah.
You can't carry shit like you know.
Correct.
But that was done by Ashu. He was from the scene, so it was a different thing altogether.
Right.
He had some good tie up with the cops as well.
Yeah.
Even if the cops would come, he would come sort the shit out.
I'm sure he kept them at bay
because he was running that place for such a long time.
Jitna chala hai, bahut jugaad se chala hai.
In fact, on weekdays also. Weekdays pe bhi kabhi bhi gig hota tha public.
I have heard B69 was a culture. Like, jo log har weekend ko could go to B69 and chill.
No, people just used to go there to hang out.
Yeah.
Sham ho gaya, chalo B69 jaate.
Right.
It was like that,
right.
And B69 gave chances to a lot of bands.
Different times.
Yeah. No, what happened in BMK3? We were like around more than 10 guys.
No, in
fourth, the
organizing. No,
in three. So everybody chipped.
Kunal was part of it.
No, in fourth,
he came in fourth. Yeah, but promotion wise he was.
Right.
So
and the sad part was everybody thought that BMK is done by Choksi. I was like,
eventually,
we were like, okay.
So in the third edition, we had like 10 plus people, and everybody chipped him equal amount. So the budget was really good. But what happened is, as they say, too many cooks spoil the soup. So everybody had their different opinions, different views. We should do it this way. We should do it that way. We should do this, that.
Mm-hmm.
So I told everybody beforehand. Participating in this, if you are a part of the team, don't expect anything in return. Just do it for the sheer love of the
Black
music.
Because that's how it started.
So it went on, but after the show got over, then when people came to know, we did not even break even, so they're like kind of pissed off and all.
Mm-hmm.
That's when I decided that the next edition, even if we do it, we're not taking so many people.
Keep it
limited, probably to only us.
Right.
And then the next edition, Choksi came on board and stuff happened.
Mm-hmm.
So we had, from France, we had Manzer come down.
Right.
They were doing like an India tour.
Right.
Yeah, so they came down. And the most weirdest part was they came down without any equipment.
He used my bass, man. I was like, can I
use
your bass? Like, Parish's
bass. The guitarist used... Sunny's or Ruach's guitar? Sunny's.
It's probably because they are endorsed and they were expecting their brand to lend them equipment when
they are an underground band.
They are very, very, underground.
They
band.
Were pretty underground. I mean, they played Vikram's show, right?
Yeah. From here, the next day they went to Bangalore along with this team.
Was it Trendslotter or was it...
No, I think the Dark Days of December, I think so.
Okay.
So, yeah, they did not have their own double bass pedal, which, again, we lended them. But they were, like, pretty happy with the entire outcome.
Help and,
They're pretty happy.
Yeah, he loved my bass so much, man. Just like I do.
So, that was probably, after that, then everything went down drastically.
Uh-huh.
We on and off, we keep on thinking, should we do another edition? But then, again, first...
But, like, Paresh was saying, like, it... ended because of a monetary reason?
No. That could be one of the reasons.
It definitely will be.
It was venues, bands. You can't keep calling
same
bands again and again
right. True.
And as I said, Black Monday, but there are very few bands.
At the same time, I will argue in the defense of same bands again and again. If it's an annual event,
Yeah.
If it's an annual event and it's a dedicated event for black metal, I think it still holds... power even if you repeat like 50% of the lineup is repeated from the previous editions it's fair. I mean
used to happen now, suppose if we play one BMK edition and till the next BMK edition we have played another 4-5 shows,
right?
And in the next BMK edition again we are playing,
right?
So
right.
People will obviously talk
get,
saying
they
that,
get
you know,
tired
so
fatigue will happen,
yeah,
right.
So keeping that into mind, we narrowed down. We said, let's not have 6-7 bands.
Right.
Because that again limits the playing time. So let's have 5 or 6 bands so that each band gets...
That's a legitimate issue. Yes, I want to talk about this specifically. I had mentioned this, that we will talk about this. Talking about Immortal versus Abbott.
Oh, damn.
Yes, Immortal versus Abbott, let them fight. This is like the... So, what about you guys? Which artist are you a fan of?
I think everybody, even in our band, is Immortal, man. Immortal.
I know, because it's a commonality I drew out myself. They are influenced by fantasy and epic, you know, war and things like that. And
no,
they don't deal with
that. Was a part of their culture, their history.
True. Yeah. I mean, obviously, everything has a context. And Immortal chose to not be satanic. Right? If I'm not wrong. Right. And y'all also, I want to have a little conversation on that also. Y'all chose to not be satanic and chose to be
But tell epic. Me really, who's really satanic in even in Indian bands? Like, they would portray it on stage
or even on social media. I will
say
Solar Deity because he owns to it, right?
But so, that is on stage. Talk to him off stage, man. Like, he's a puppy, dude. I'm coming down to that again.
No,
but,
I mean, he's like the most, so I would say satanic bands, okay,
on social media, yeah.
Would also involve a lot
not
of
in person.
Misanthropy.
If he would be same as he portrays on social media, I'll be like, oh fuck.
Being in a place like Bombay or even in India
or metal scene,
because
kitna bada
our culture
yaar.
Is like that. You can't portray that even in your daily life.
Yeah.
Because you, I mean, the way.
What if you like the image of Satan? What do you like the idea of Satan?
There's
like,
nothing wrong.
Like, I'll go back to Zeelanarder. Okay, I'll go back to Zeelanarder. He's a black man living in France. He has nothing to do with Satanism, but he's using the concept.
To get an idea out. But it's just,
and
like,
music
it's just like any other religion, man.
It doesn't have to be.
But
are Behemoth satanic?
They portrays.
On stage.
They use themes.
Yeah exactly. Just
they
like Slayer. Like, everybody calls them satanic, but they are not.
No. That's like really old Slayer also, if you have to really boil it down to black magic and things like that.
No, especially Jews and everybody, they think like Slayer are fucking satanic.
And that is, if you're looking at like, you know, conservative people looking at metal bands, they will say everything is satanic.
Yeah.
I'm talking about specifically guys who endorse
Satan. Except Immortal, man.
Right, except Immortal. So, what binds y'all with Immortal? Are y'all on Abbott's side? Are y'all on Immortal's side?
We were real. I'll be extremely honest. I'll be extremely honest. No, all of us were on the Abbott's side when the split happened. We were like,
no.
No, bro. You balls.
Balls.
No, bro.
Balls.
Bro, we were like, kya baap hai
mein? This is war.
Yehi Immortal hai. Kya baap hai? Bhimchot. Kya maza hai sunke? But when the new album came out, we were fucking blown away.
Dude, the Abbott
because
album
everybody
is kick-ass.
Abbott album
is kick-ass.
Everybody
but again, you know what happened, right? The bassist King, you know the reason why he left the band?
No, I don't know background.
The lyrics of the new Abbott album are more pointing towards religion.
Oh, okay.
So that is why King, who also used to play for Gorgoroth, which is one of the most fucking satanic bands.
Satan.
In fact, they are the people who portray it even in real life.
Right.
If you'll see one
interview
Not everybody. But King.
Yeah.
Now, for example, Gal, the vocalist.
Gal, yeah.
Okay.
He's famous, dude.
There's this one
15 and Gal's
interview.
Gay, bro.
That I don't know.
Gal's grey, imagine.
Grey.
Gay, he's gay, man.
Possibly, sure.
So there's this one 15-minute interview
like
of
so
him.
That's like so satanic, huh?
Wherein these American people, they go to Norway, and Gal stays on this one mountain, wherein there are just 5 to 6 houses.
Mm-hmm.
That is his grandfather's land,
yeah,
no?
That is right on top.
Yeah.
So this guy actually follows what he portrays.
Right.
Okay, he lives in
isolation.
He lives in isolation. He's gone to a school wherein there has been just one more other child. That's it. Okay? He has only candles lit in his entire house. Walls are cut full of paintings. He'll dress up
like
only
he has
black.
Given up on technology, modern life, all of that. Huh.
So, these people actually...
But I would like to know his
well.
WhatsApp number, man.
He must be nodding on WhatsApp.
Exactly.
Of course. You can't expect
that shit. Yeah, as I said, because the place that you live in, if suppose Bombay was also like, maybe like Norway, you may never know. Some people might actually, you know,
explore more of that kind of music.
But
sure.
There's nothing, I mean, as you don't have anything much to explore here in Bombay, apart from local trains and all that shit.
You've got a lot of groove happening though.
But are you aware of this thing? Gal does clean vocals on his drummer's project, which is called Wardruna.
Oh, Wardruna, right?
Yeah, he does clean vocals.
Dude, Wardruna is like full-on epic fantasy, right?
Exactly, but he does clean vocals on that. You look at him and you'll be like, fuck, ye to Satanism to follow nahi karta hoga.
Right.
He has that picture,
See, so the essential point being that Satan and like the image of Satan and Satanism is all symbolic. It's all used to either as as a mark of protest, or as a way of dabbling with the occult, or like, you know, unexplained phenomena, or to dabble with things that must not be spoken of. So you're stepping upon taboos.
No, see, for
like
me,
cultural taboos.
For me, according to Satanism, according to me, okay, this is my perception.
Right.
I think Satanism has nothing to do with devil.
Okay.
It's a way of living life. So
that is Lovian Satanism.
Yeah.
Huh.
So
right.
So
there's no worship involved.
Exactly.
Huh.
So basically, there are certain rules that you have to follow, like any other religion.
So the Lovian Satanism.
Exactly. There are 10 different Satanist cultures,
right?
Like every Satanist culture is different. Just like Hindu religion, every way follows Hindu religion is different in a different way.
Right.
They praise different gods.
So,
like, for example.
Just to bemuse you, I will say Aditya Mehta is a Lavian Satanist. as much as he would like to document and say that he is.
I have nothing to say on this.
Okay. Fuck that. Immortal still rules.
Yeah, immortal rules, right?
Immortal.
You're in favor of immortal.
Immortal.
So you all stay true to immortal. What about the new album? What do you all think about?
Fucking amazing.
Because
it took a shit on everybody's comments on social media. Immortal's gonna say it.
Fuck,
bro.
Right.
Everybody was shitting on Immortal's page, YouTube videos, like, fuck, Immortal's over, this, that,
so,
blah, blah. Fuck you, fucking posers being shown. Immortal is bad.
No, I'll say, like, now being like the non-core black metal fan, okay? Like, I've been on the fringe, strictly on the fringe. I enjoy Abath purely because he's so heavy metal oriented.
Hmm.
I have been in a heavy metal act. I know how it feels to, like,
he has a heavy metal band called I.
Oh, yeah. It was just a one-off,
one,
I think.
One album.
So, that's what reminds me. Like, you know, Abath is still... Once again, he's still introducing the music to a larger...
Abath basically... Yeah, he is a good vocalist.
Abath is a brand.
Sure.
So is
Immortal.
Immortal is bigger than Abath.
It is bigger than Abath. That's why it's like...
It still exists, but then... When it comes to Norwegian people and their culture and European countries, Abath is considered like... Immortal. Before this album, they're like, Abath is every fucking thing.
Hmm.
But very moment this album came out.
As for me, why Abath is Abath? Because the gimmicks that he does on stage.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, he does that crab walk.
Yeah.
In some one concert, he ran up the hill
and he fell down.
And he fell down with the guitar. Basically, I would
say. And he's laughing, dude, and he's like,
yeah.
fuck this shit.
Some people do that on purpose to get that, you know, okay, I'm falling down still, I'm, you know, playing.
Yeah,
sometimes
he's
lying down on the ground and shit, you know.
Right.
But yeah.
Basically, AC/DC. Black metal AC/DC, bro.
Not AC/DC. Actually, you're the wrong man. He is supremely influenced by Kiss.
Kiss.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Kiss's
tongue was out.
I mean, that's like the music he grew up with as a kid. Like, that's why, like, he
attributes. Yeah, that's most
to.
Of
but
the
now,
band,
now,
man.
Now, since Abath is Abath, now, if Immortal comes up with a lineup to perform live, that would be something really,
they're still
watch.
Figuring it out, right? Because Dimonas is now doing both vocals and guitars.
Vocals and guitars. Now, they don't have a bassist. Peter Tagan played bass on this one, vocalist of Hypocrisy.
Okay.
Hogg is...
Yeah, fuck, he did an amazing fucking job, and I fucking love Hypocrisy, even though I don't like death metal that much, but... great fucking job, man. Fucking awesome.
So yeah, this is actually, it's kind of now meshed into a segment that I always do like on every podcast, which is called Notes from the Underground. So I ask bands to, like, you know, rep the best act that they think, or the best release that they think in the recent past.
Yeah,
that is like worthy of discussion. So I'm sure, I won't say Immortal's underground in the slightest.
Not at all.
But it is definitely the torchbearer for the underground. They...
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, they bear the torch. Everyone else is following them in a way. And I would say, I dare say even you guys are supremely
But you know what I feel? My perception is...
I would draw a striking parallel, dude. I heard the Immortal album, I heard you all, and I was like, I know what's happening.
See,
here.
Immortal's Abath, when I initially started listening to Immortal, and if you've heard of the band called Nargaroth.
Yeah.
Okay, so Khan Wolf, Nargaroth, and Immortal Abath. These two guys have influenced me a lot to do the vocals that
on
I do.
On your
today.
Style on it, okay.
Yeah.
But you know what our perception
any other new acts that you would want to recommend? both of your
albums. Shoot. Like, for example, for me, these days, I'm listening to a lot of this Finnish black metal band called Asgaroth.
Okay.
So they recently released an album called Ikiunten Mailas.
Okay.
So in English, it means the land of the day.
Okay.
It's like atmosphere.
Land of the day.
Yeah, land of the day.
Atmospheric black.
Yes.
Sweet.
Atmospheric black metal slash folk metal.
I shall check it out. I like folk and black metal.
Yeah, yeah. It's
that.
Fucking amazing.
Sweet.
I would say even the new Marduk album, Victoria, is really kicking.
When
ass.
Was this out?
A year ago? No. This year, 2018.
Oh, it's an 18 release.
Yeah.
Interesting.
It is really a kick-ass album.
Oh, sweet.
So, Immortal and Marduk, these,
like,
this year are like the top contenders.
Ruling. Uh-huh.
But there are some good bands. Like, there is this Quebec band called Fortress.
Okay.
Oh, damn.
Okay.
Fucking amazing band.
Very, very good black metal band from Canada. Sorry, Quebec.
Yeah.
Do check them out as well.
Sweet.
Then you also have this year, this got released, Funeral Mist, which is the side project of the vocalist of Marduk.
Sweet.
Which has this black metal come rock and roll feel.
Uh-huh. I know, black and roll.
Black and roll, yeah.
Yeah, that's Satyricon style.
Yeah, because if this is black metal, then it'll sound just like a replica of Mardu.
Right.
But the last Dark Throne album was fucking awesome, man. Mm-hmm. I really like the last Dark Throne album.
Mm-hmm.
I think
Thunder.
It had come last year, right?
Arctic Thunder.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
It had come last year.
Sweet.
It was really good.
Mm-hmm. Like, I would like to pick out certain acts that I think are like really kick-ass. Primary being Deathspell Omega.
Okay.
Home.
And they fucking rip your concept of musicality. They rip it apart. And I love the trilogy that they've made, like right up to Paracletus.
Mm.
And the newer work is also, they put out an EP,
after
that.
2018.
Yeah. Right now. That's very dense.
Deathspell Omega is, again, I think so, they're from France.
Yeah. French black metal.
In fact, the drummer of Manza Shazgul is ex Deathspell Omega.
Oh.
So I remember I had asked him one question regarding Deathspell Omega. So he's like, I don't want to talk about that.
Oh.
So I'm like, okay. All due respect, I will not ask you anything. Yeah, Deathspell Omega, I would say they are probably, they come in that avant-garde
black metal.
They're pushing
the territories of what black metal is. And conceptually also very rich. Because the trilogy has a meaning to it.
Another similar band would be Blood Us Nord.
Yeah, Blood Us Nord. Yeah.
They also very,
mixing
very,
industrial.
Very good.
Yeah.
Very good.
Mixing post-rock industrial.
Yeah, but again, people who actually want only one type of black metal, like the raw and the fast, they will not enjoy such
bands. Exactly, that's me.
They will not enjoy such bands.
But what about like bands like Amenra? Like, they're doing so well right now. Like, they come from roots that are very black metal oriented.
Yeah, but still,
they've like incorporated that.
Yeah, they have a really good sound. They have really good sound.
And even thematically, so you know, I just read, Ashish shared a link with me. The vocalist of Amenra, he pierces his back with hooks.
Yeah.
And he levitates on stage.
Even this guy from Shining does it.
Fuck, have you seen
have
Shining
you seen
on
Shining?
Stage?
Shining is the Norwegian black...
Swedish.
And in fact, he doesn't like to call themselves as a
black metal band.
Right.
Fuck, that guy is crazy.
He's
on
really
stage,
crazy.
Man.
He cuts himself, I think so, somebody shared a link with me wherein he's actually cut some flesh from some...
His guitarist
flesh, and he's shoved it in a girl's mouth.
Exactly. Fuck, it's crazy,
man.
Oh,
wow, okay.
He's really crazy. But the music,
it's amazing.
Especially the clean parts.
Not just only for all these antics, but the
music
is so
really
good, man.
Right.
So good it is.
People must be thinking, you know, looking at him, he must be a dick. He, you know, he fucking drinks half of the time. You know,
he always drinks GD on stage, man.
Yeah, but then the music that they write, what actually happens, what we see live is something different. But what happens behind the scenes when they go into the studio and how they work their ass off to
write a great record. Huh?
Yeah. And they take like years to write stuff.
And
when they know everything is in place, then they start recording.
Right.
So Shining is a really good band.
I fucking love Shining, man. So yeah, like my main discussion was like, you know, to build some context to like guiding listeners to what the scene has been like specifically with Bombay black metal through you guys. And coming to, like, you know, your release, so Covenant of Black. How was the response, actually? I would like to know that. How was the response to Covenant
of Black? Good response. The majority of the good
from
response
abroad.
is we getting from abroad countries because they like the kind of music more.
Right.
We've been getting response from here also as well, but not as per our expectations.
Right.
But nevertheless, we did what we had to do. We put out the CD. We, you know, written good songs and stuff.
Right.
We went to Kunal Choksi. He did a good job of printing the CD and the T-shirts as well.
Right.
So yeah.
He handled the distribution for the.
Yeah. It's released on his label, so he's
okay.
handled most of the distribution.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Any local people, if anybody want to get the CDs and all, they can get in touch with us. So, as I said, the response abroad has been really phenomenal. People are like, when we tell them that we are from India, they're like, India? India has black metal bands?
Yeah.
That is a, you know, question you get first.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's been good abroad.
Okay.
So we're looking to, I don't know, maybe in the future, probably to play shows abroad.
Okay.
And the reviews also that we've got, people have written some really good reviews about the album as well.
Mm-hmm.
I remember this one review, this guy used the way he expressed the way he described each and every song of ours, and he praised Vinit's drumming, Ruak's guitaring as well.
Was this US webzine?
I don't remember the name because there have been so many.
So
it's been really, you know, good to see, you know, your hard work getting appreciated.
Right.
You know, in such aspects.
Right.
So yeah, it's been good so far.
What I'd like to, even I gave the album, like, you know, a couple of listens. And so it's not my brand. Like I said, you might guess my taste by now. You might have, like, you know, gotten at least a hint of it.
I go.
You definitely do. We've spoken more also. We have not spoken as much before. So basically, what I understand is that it's very raw, old school, like, you know, relentless black metal.
But wait, do you like Bangalore bands?
Which one?
Any old school bands?
I mean, I love Kryptos. I mean, sure.
Okay, other than Kryptos.
I love old Bavers here. I'm not a huge fan of the second album. I absolutely love Shepherd.
Oh, they are fucking cool, man.
Then, I think black metal-wise, you know, Dark Desolation is pretty decent.
Dark Desolation is good.
I mean, my attention was brought to them because Siri from Against Evil did a kick-ass video for them.
Yeah. Because Ajay and they are childhood friends.
Oh.
They were together since their childhood in Vizag.
Oh, I see.
I think they were together in school.
Sweet. That's damn cute, man.
Yeah.
But he actually made something really good for them. And I watched that video and I was like, why aren't people paying attention? Like, this is damn kick-ass.
Yeah, the video was pretty good.
Yeah.
I think so. That was with the old lineup. After that, they had a very big lineup change.
Yeah.
Paresh is part of the lineup now.
Right. Oh, ha! Right. Yeah. You guessed. I forgot about that. So basically, what I thought about the album is, like, it's relentless, you know, raw black metal, like very high intensity black metal, which in a long duration listen is not really my taste. But I'll tell you one song that I really liked was As Life Descends.
Oh, nice. It has a little atmospheric touch.
Is why I dig it.
That's the second song, the second track.
So that was a song that I kind of enjoyed out of the entire, you know, the entire album. But yeah, it's great to know that y'all are getting a good response internationally. And
We are on streaming site. Ghana.com, baby.
That's where I kind of checked y'all out on Apple Music only. What's happening, what I feel in the contemporary space, so since coming back to bands that I also dig, the crossover audience I feel is significantly larger. It's maybe my guesstimate, it's a guesstimate that they are significantly larger than your old school black metal and, you know, your true to roots black metal. And There exists a certain potential in exploring new territory with black metal. And I will definitely hand over black metal the credit of being so malleable over the years that people have experimented with it and done so much, like, so many amazing things. And what is it that drives Stark Denial to sticking to the old school road?
See, basically, our inspiration is basically, again, the old school, the first wave, second wave of black metal bands.
Right.
So we've already, as you said, we've stuck to our roots. So now we will obviously go in that direction as well. So if you hear the album properly, and if you've heard any of the first or the second wave black metal bands, there's a lot of influence.
Right, definitely.
Yeah, there's a lot of influence. Like, for example, Paresh would get influenced by Immortal. He has the tattoo of Immortal.
Yeah.
So Stark Denial, when we started off, we actually started off in 2006.
Mm-hmm.
That time it was just me, Ruak. We've had... many people might not be knowing, we have a lot of musicians come and jammed with us. We had Yash Patak jam with us on drums. We had Ravi Satpute jam with us on bass for
from
like a couple of jams.
Yeah, yeah.
We had Srikant from Koshish also jam with us.
Okay.
But then eventually they faded away
right.
and they went on their own
interests.
Interests and stuff. So then from 2006, we were really struggling to have a lineup. But initially when we started off as a death metal band.
Mm-hmm.
So then one day we decided, let's do something, as I said, let's do something different which nobody has done before. So we shifted on to black metal.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, because the proper lineup was not there, so we went dormant.
Mm-hmm.
But then 2009, come 2009, when we discovered Shawik, then we had Apoy on guitars and we had Felix on bass. So that is the time we wrote the first single called The Unknown Word, which is on the album.
Right.
And from there it slowly picked up. So then from 2009 onwards till now, it's just been me and Ruak in the band so far. And then now with this lineup with Paresh and Vinit. So we had two guitarists at a time, but then that also did not work out. So we stuck to just one guitar.
Right. Because I've seen you all with two guitars.
Yeah. So we now just down to just four people.
Mm-hmm.
And
I understand. It makes your sound a lot more clearer.
Yeah,
and stuff,
yeah.
Right?
Because
two guitars,
sometimes one guitar is overlaying the other guitar, so you can't hear clearly what exactly
the
other main guitarist is playing.
Right.
So that is how it's been so far. A lot of ups and downs. So we've released one EP before through Ajaya's label called...
Incan Productions.
It's titled War. Basically, that EP was, as the name says itself, pretty self-explanatory, War. So we were fascinated. That time I was more into playing God of War on PS. So I was like whole fascinated with the whole concept, me and Ruak. So we said, let's name the EP called War. So we have songs all based on the war. So everything related to war is captured in that. And we did cover of Marduk as well.
Panzer Division
Marduk.
Right.
And then as you grow older and older as a musician, you become much more mature towards what you want in your next album. Now, as we four are standing together as a band, so we are representing a covenant.
Right.
So instead of writing legion or an army and all, like, you know, let's write it, because we've been doing this from a long time.
Right.
And
as a small unit.
Yeah, as a small unit. Even though we're just four of us, and because now he's a band manager.
Right.
So, but I said, let's name it Covenant of and Black, basically the genre.
Correct.
So that's how the name came up.
Right.
Now, if you the title track Covenant of Black, have you heard the track?
Yeah.
The intro, you'll hear the fire and the screech, and then you hear me saying those lines. The lines are what? We are the flesh of one temple. We are the force of this continuum. We assemble as one. We dominate who stand in path.
Right.
Simple. Don't fuck with us. We won't fuck with you.
Right. And that's your attitude as
exactly.
Yeah.
That's how we are
that's
even on stage.
That would summarize.
That's
more
how even
yeah.
we are on stage, off stage.
Sweet.
Fuck you.
And that goes out to all the satanic.
It's okay. Tum log jo kehte hain kehte
ho. Everybody has their own perception.
Vision
and,
of
yeah.
what
so
music is.
Do whatever you want, just don't hurt anybody.
Keep
man.
Doing what you're doing.
Right.
We've been doing that as well. And
right.
try to influence others rather than harming others.
Right.
That's one good thing.
Sweet.
Yeah, some people might say, oh fuck, these are black metal band guys and they're talking about, you know, doing good and shit and all. That is what everybody is, basically, they when they are black metal, it's like the typical stereotype, black metal means satanic, or you wear only black
but
t-shirts
people
and
don't even
shit
know
like
anything
that.
About Satanism, man. I don't even understand. How can you even come to that point where you're like, fuck, ye to Satanist hai ya the bench aur pata to hai kya Satanist kya hota hai? Shoot, Antichrist hai kya tu? But... Antichrist, Satanism, two alleged.
Tell me just
but
a little bit about your perception towards religion as a band. I'd like have it clear out.
I do believe in the high power. I do.
Alright.
I'm religious.
Alright.
Since day one. Alright. Always been and I always will be.
Like, for example, I don't believe in any god. If you would ask me, like, if I go to any gun.
What about the rest of the members?
Even Ruach. Same.
Yeah, Ruach is a pretty
or religious. Agnostic at best, not like not atheist.
No.
I was at some point, but then down the line, I learned and realized many things. So I do believe in the higher power, because I think somewhere down the line, even I have felt it.
Mm-hmm.
But I wouldn't say ki like there's a particular god. See, there's
I know.
There's a lot of difference between
you
god.
You trust in an entity.
There's a lot of difference between God and Lord.
Right.
There could be n number of gods, but Lord is like the Almighty. You know, it could be in any form. Like, for example, in Christians, it's Jesus. In Muslims, it's Allah.
Hmm.
In Hindus, it could be XYZ.
Hmm.
But Hindus have too many gods. So, yeah, you never
right.
know.
Right.
So, yeah.
So that's pretty much it. We've done a huge round of discussions with Stark Denial about everything from religion to black metal to, like, you know, what our favorite picks are globally, to the growth of black metal as a movement in Bombay, to, you know, the peak of black metal in Bombay and what it is currently, and like how these guys stand tall for the covenant of black, because they are the only active black metal band anymore, right? If I'm not wrong. Yes, there is no active black metal band playing around anymore.
Bombay, I guess. Yeah.
Yes. It's true. So yeah, man, that's pretty much it. Like, we've wrapped this up. I hope you guys enjoy digging through all the recommendations, all the references that we've shared with y'all. And I hope that this contingent grows stronger with each every day.
Yes, and Immortal is better than Abba.
And yes, I love that. I love that one personally. That's my favorite bit. Chalo. So that's about it. I'm Siddharth.
Kunal.
Paresh. I don't know why that accent though.
That's just Paresh being cute. So cheers and stay Haramcore.